Like I said, it's a great pleasure to introduce Tommaso. I've known Tommaso for maybe, I would say, 20 years or more, since he was finishing his PhD with Lamberto Maffei at the CNR in Pisa. At the Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa. And I would have to say that Tommaso's PhD work coincided, and so there may well be a causal relationship here with what I regard as one of the great periods of creativity in Lamberto Maffei's lab in examining mechanisms of visual cortical plasticity. So since the days of Hubel and Wiesel, who first demonstrated the phenomenon that if you close one eye during a critical period in an animal, in a critical period of development, they worked on monkeys and cats. But then subsequently, several labs, importantly Lamberto Maffei's, took these models and implemented them in rodents, in rats, and subsequently in mice as transgenic mice came along. So our own Mark Baer, as well as Mike Stryker and others began to work with mice, but Lamberto's lab was one of the first that began to work with rodent models, including rats. And I think Tommaso's work during the early 90s set the stage for a huge explosion of mechanisms that might be responsible for why is it that if you close an eye for a few days, or actually even for a few hours during this developmental critical window, responses from the closed eye go down sharply. And after some period of time, it was later found responses from the open eye go up. And so, just to make a long story short, Tommaso's work then in Lamberto's lab spanned mechanisms such as the neurotrophins, looking at the effects of nerve growth factor, BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, and subsequently went deeper downstream of these factors through a cyclic AMP response element binding protein such as CREB, or known as CREB, or extracellular signal-related kinase ERK. And then in a remarkably a creative leap, Tommaso examined the role of the extracellular matrix, stuff that lives outside of neurons, in mediating such synaptic and circuit-level plasticity, including the effect of chondroitin sulfate proteoglycans. This is the glue that binds neurons' pre- and postsynaptic elements together. Continuing on, Tommaso has looked at histones and the post-translational modification mechanisms mediated by histones, microRNAs, regulatory elements in the genome, such as microRNA 132, as well as metal metalloproteases and so forth. All of this has really opened up the field of why is it that neurons and synapses change when you alter activity in their inputs and also in conjunction with their targets. Tommaso's recent work has taken him into then using these mechanisms to examine the animal models of brain disorders, such as Rett syndrome. He's looked at the effects of signaling pathways in animals, mice with the gene MECP2 mutated that are models of Rett syndrome. He's looked at signal pathways like AKT and mTOR signaling pathways that interest us as well. He's looked at environmental enrichment. These are all outside the box thinking. And most recently, he's looked at CDKL5 mutation models as well. So I see here that Tommaso, who is now in the Department of Neurophysiology, in the Department of Psychology, I understand, but associate professor of neurophysiology in the University of Florence. He's received interesting prizes. He received in 2003 the Medal of the President of the Italian Republic for Young Investigators in Neuroscience. So I'm assuming you got to meet the President of the Italian Republic rather than some surrogate. And then he has received other prizes as well. So it's a great pleasure. And we thank you for braving the weather and taking so much trouble to get here.
Thank you. Okay, so Can you hear me? The mic is. So thank you very much, Mirganka. And you know, it was a long trip, actually, but it was really worth, because I really enjoy today speaking with all the students and visiting the different labs. It's really, of course, it's a great place to do science here, and I really learn a lot. So. As I wrote here in the title, I will talk about Rett syndrome, synaptic alterations. But before talking about Rett syndrome, I put some slides on to show you how I arrived at studying Rett syndrome, and also showing to you some new data that are still unpublished on some epigenetic mechanisms that occurs during developmental plasticity of the visual cortex, and that could be related to what happens in Rett syndrome. So my original interest, as was already underscored by Mirganka, are these developmental cortical plasticity periods that are called critical periods that occurs in the sensory system, but also in other systems, in language or in cognition. So there are these periods during which plasticity is particularly high. Of course, this does not mean that there is no plasticity afterwards. It just means that the plasticity is particularly present during these periods. So the model that we use in the lab to study cortical plasticity was ocular dominance plasticity. It was introduced in the literature by, as you see here, the Hubel and Wiesel that got the Nobel Prize for this. And as you know very well, basically this consists in just closing one eye for a few days or hours. And what you get, if you recall from the visual cortex, you have this so-called ocular dominance shift. So the cells become responsive to the open eye and lose responses to the deprived eye. So the big question that we try to ask and answer possibly was, what is so important in visual experience that if you just take out this factor, even for a few, in a brief period of time, then you get this disruption of cortical response. So the loss of vision also, and the loss of responsiveness. So at least part of the effect is probably due to experience-dependent regulation of transcription. So by the fact that neurons, of course, respond to a stimulus in terms of changes in the membrane potential, but also respond to a stimulus in terms of a biochemical change, so in the activation of transcription of certain genes. And this is interesting not only, of course, for ocular dominance plasticity or learning, but it's interesting also in the field of these neurodevelopmental disorders, for instance. I took this picture from a review by Michael Greenberg, and he was making the point that you see that mutation in different genes in this cascade that puts together activity with transcription involve syndromes which are characterized by autism or mental retardation. And this is another paper, very recent analysis, one of the largest analysis of the genetic causes, I mean, the genetic associations to autism. And you see, if you group the genes that were found, they belong to these synaptic, transcriptional, and chromatin genes. So putting together the synaptic alteration that could be, you know, the final outcome, with the control of transcription. So, and in particular, the genes related to chromatin control, so relating to the so-called epigenetic factors like DNA methylation or post-translational modification of histones. So, our study of the effect of visual experience started years ago, and we made this very simple observation that if you put an animal into darkness and then put back the animals into light, and then you make a molecular analysis of the visual cortex, you find activation of a cascade that involves, for instance, this kinase that becomes quickly activated, ERK, in 2.5 minutes after you switch on the light. In a young mouse, you already see phosphorylation, translocation to the nucleus, and activation of all these factors that control transcription. And interestingly, you see activation of transcription factors, but also activation of dysphosphorylation, methylation, acetylation of histones. So experience is able to quickly modulate the state of the chromatin, because you know that this post-translational modification can change the accessibility of the chromatin and then change transcription. And what you get is gene expression. In particular, in this experiment, we use a mouse that where the reporter was produced as a function of the activity of Krebs. So it was a reporter of Krebs activity. And with this stimulation, you could get Krebs-mediated gene expression in 1 hour. What happens if we do the same stimulation in an adult animal? We got a similar activation until this point. So at the transcriptional level, we saw a much less effectiveness of the visual stimulation. So the kinases were active, all these things were active, but then we would see reduced phosphorylation, reduced acetylation, and reduced Krebs-mediated gene expression. Again, this does not mean that there was no effect. Actually, even in the adult, we could get a small effect, but the effect was much, much smaller. So the idea was, okay, why don't we try to reinstate, for instance, histone acetylation that you can do pharmacological, treating with these HDAC inhibitors, and see in an adult animal and see whether we can reactivate plasticity. And this plasticity can be used, for instance, to recover from a long-term monocular deprivation that was begun during the critical period. So when you have an adult animal and you reopen an eye that has been deprived for 100 days, normally the visual acuity remains at low level. You can get a small recovery, but it never goes to the normal level. And these experiments were done in rats, adult rats. And the idea is, if we are able to enhance plasticity in the adult rat by acting on histone acetylation, can we have a recovery of visual acuity? So this is the protocol. This is the estimate of visual acuity using this Pruski method. If one wants to know more, we can deal with that in the questions. So here we analyze acuity of the open eye. Then we do this protocol of reopening the previously deprived eye and then closing the other eye. We estimate acuity of the deprived eye. Then we do treatments. We did valproic, but we also did other HDAC inhibitors. Of course, each of them has some side effects, some specific effects, but the fact that you see the same effect with many of them points to the fact that the action is mediated by inhibition of HDACs. And then you can remeasure acuity of the eye, the deprived eye, that was assessed before treatment. And this is just an example of two animals, one control animal and one treated with the HDAC inhibitor. Basically, what you do is you do the test increasing the spatial frequency of the grating, and if there is a black symbol, it means that the animal was able to see this stimulus. And this is before or after the treatment. And you see that you increase the spatial frequency, the animal does the task correctly. At a certain point, you see success, mistake. This means that the visual acuity was reached. It's oscillating around the threshold of spatial resolution. And this is a control animal. Before or after a saline treatment, basically, you don't get the visual acuity that you get is the same. But here is an animal treated with this HDAC inhibitor, and this is before the treatment, this is after the same animal. You see that now it can recover. Of course, with these HDAC inhibitors, you don't have that, you know, immediately you have this acuity. It could be that it's a kind of effect of visual training, visual learning. It's interesting that this treatment now has been used in so many different fields, and now there was this very provocative paper that was published in a frontier journal saying that even that people treated with valproate as adults could reopen this critical period for absolute pitch. But okay, it This is interesting, but we know that we are regulating transcription. And in particular, we knew that CREB-mediated gene transcription was interesting. So what could be a candidate gene that was mediating this effect? And we follow a candidate approach, so we browse the literature for CREB-regulated genes, strongly regulated. And so we met this microRNA, miR-132, that was particularly interesting to us because it was a strongly regulated by electrical activity in culture. It was a strongly CREB-dependent, and it was shown by Morgan Shen group that it could regulate the formation and stabilization of dendritic protrusion, dendritic spines, and also at a functional level, so at anatomical and functional level. We first checked whether it was regulated by visual experience, so we did this short period of dark ring, and we measured both the precursor and the mature form. And you could see that there is a strong downregulation if you put the animal in darkness. You put back the animal into the light, you see only 1 hour, 45 minutes, and you have a strong upregulation. So it's really a dynamical microRNA. And we also wanted to test whether there was a relationship between this epigenetic change that we observe at the level of histone post-translational modification and the activation or transcription of this gene. So we perform chromatin immunoprecipitation for this different modification of histones and in darkness or after light exposure. And basically, we could see induction of all these three modifications at this particular Cray sequence, the CREB responsive sequence, and only for acetylation at this other CREB responsive sequence. And we know from mutational data that deleting this sequence, you have a strong reduction in transcription. So they are very important for transcription. This was just a kind of a positive control. And so what happened in adult animals? In adult animals, we got a reduction in the activation, light induction of this microRNA, but when we added tricostatin that promotes histone acetylation, visual stimulation was able to induce the microRNA much more than was doing normally. So by facilitating histone acetylation, you could enhance light responsiveness of the microRNA in the adult. So, okay, the next experiment was if we take a monocrine deprived animal, we also observe a reduction in the expression of the microRNA because it's activity dependent. But what if we compensate this reduction by supplying exogenously a microRNA mimic that was a chemically modified microRNA? And actually, by recording single unit of visually evoked potentials, we could observe that normally you get a reduction in the amplitude response to the deprived eye. These are critical period animals. And this reduction does not occur in the animals in which basically we had compensated for the activity-dependent reduction of microRNA. So in this case, in these animals, this group here, the normal reduction that should occur was not occurring, and there was no plasticity. So we came up with a model that tried to discuss this data together with the data that were published by the group of Mirganka, and the first author was Nicolas Melios, and where he was showing that also if you have a complete reduction of this microRNA, you also block plasticity. So considering its role in the stabilization, for instance, in dendritic spines, we thought that could be an optimal window for plasticity. When you have a high expression of this microRNA, which happens normally during the end of the critical period, you could have that the spines are very mature, so more difficult to change. And you have to reduce a little bit the expression to get plasticity, but if you reduce too much, you could have an excessive instability, so no consolidation of the plasticity mechanism. But then we continue to work on this and said, okay, so probably post-translational modifications of histones play some role, an important role, in ocular dominance plasticity, in cortical plasticity. But of course, they probably work in concert with other epigenetic modifications. And so considering all these papers, just we took only five of them, and there are others, of course, in the literature, showing that even DNA methylation, so methylation of cytosine, can be dynamic, more dynamic than previously thought. So what happens, again, in the system, in the ocular dominance plasticity of the visual cortex? So the question was, is DNA methylation regulated by sensory stimulation? So in our paradigm, just switching on the light and switching or putting the animals in darkness. And is this regulation important for plasticity? So we first analyzed just the expression of the DNMTs, the enzymes that catalyze the methylation of cytosine. And in the deprived cortex, so the cortex is contralateral to the deprived eye, we have a significant increase in the expression of all these three DNMTs. Although, honestly, the NMT3B is the absolute expression level is extremely low. So when we try to do this with Western blot, we could never get the signal for the NMT3B. But at this stage of development, the most expressed DNMTs are the 3A and the 1. We could confirm at protein level this increase. So we analyze other factors involved in the regulation of methylation and also in the so-called demethylation pathway. And for instance, we found that these GADD45 factors are also regulated, but in an opposite way, by monocular deprivation. And so this leads to a scenario in which basically when we do the monocular deprivation, we activate plasticity, and this should shift the balance towards methylation when you deprive the animal. So we went directly to test whether cytosine methylation was present in these genes that were important for plasticity. One was our usual microRNA, miR-132, because it sits in a CpG island where you have there is a high chance to have a dynamic regulation of cytosine methylation. And this is the deprived cortex, and this is an experiment done with methylated DNA immunoprecipitation. And you see that we could collect more of the methylated DNA in the deprived cortex with respect to the non-deprived cortex. This is another gene of interest. It's the exon 4 transcript of BDNF, the one that is more activity dependent. It was previously found in a paper by Martinovich and colleagues to be regulated by DNA methylation as a function of activity in culture. And also in this case, we could see an increase in methylation. We also repeat this data using a different technique, so using the bisulfite sequencing of these fragments. But the results was the same. We also analyzed another crescite that is upstream of the miR-132 gene, but we couldn't see a significant induction for these crescite. So basically, these are the two genes. These are the different sites that we tested, and when you deprive, we could see significant increase in methylation on these sites, but not on this one. Of course, we know that there is a balance between methylation and this demethylation process. And one possible intermediate in the demethylation process is the hydroxymethylation. So we reason, if we repeat this time immunoprecipitation for hydroxymethylated DNA that is normally associated with active gene transcription, we should get an opposite scenario. And indeed, what we observe that when we deprive, The same sites where we could observe an increase in methylation, this time we observe a decrease in hydroxymethylation. So suggesting when you deprive, you switch from hydroxymethylation to methylation and then to transcriptional repression. Again, this technique, this result was obtained with hydroxymethylated DNA immunoprecipitation, but also with another technique where you can immunoprecipitate a product of the bisulfite conversion that is specific for hydroxymethyl cytosine. This is a technique that was developed by Anjana Rao in San Diego, and that kindly gave us the antibody to do this. If we have the activation of methylation, we have the action of the NMTs, what happens if we block the NMTs? So we use this inhibitor that was used in other papers in the field, RG108, and we infuse it in the cortex. And then we repeat our monocular deprivation. So this time we are comparing the same DNA sites. And this is the cortex treated with the NMT inhibitor. This is the cortex treated with vehicle. In the vehicle, we could repeat the activation that we observed before. But when we blocked the NMTs, now there was no more DNA induction of DNA methylation. So our treatment was effective in blocking DNA methylation. What happens to transcription of these genes? And you see that normally, when you do monocular deprivation, you reduce the expression of both transcript 4 of BDNF and the mature MIR-132. But when you apply monocular deprivation but the NMTs are blocked, the reduction is not present anymore. So this would suggest that for these two genes, the action of deprivation is mediated by DNA methylation. So we decided to see whether this was a general thing or it was specific for only these two genes. And so we used RNA sequencing from the visual cortex, and we basically did two comparisons. One was just the effect of monocular deprivation. So compare a deprived cortex with a non-deprived cortex. And in this case, we could observe, you see, 330 significantly downregulated genes and 194 upregulated genes. The other comparison that we did was a cortex that was treated with RG108 or vehicle. And in this case, we got the genes that were regulated changing the expression by blocking the NMTs. So then we crossed these two results, and we observed that you see that there are genes in common, but you see that they stay on the diagonal on this table. What does it mean? Here you have the genes that are upregulated by RG108, and almost none of the genes that are upregulated by RG108 is also upregulated by monocular deprivation. Regulation is always opposite. So when monocular deprivation downregulate one gene, RG108 bring it back to normal expression. And the same thing when for the opposite regulation. And this is specific because the other thing almost never happened. This is not significant and this is zero. So this suggests that there is a part of the transcriptional program activated by monocular deprivation, and to be precise, 71 genes, about 14% of this program that needs DNMTs active to occur. So of course, monocular deprivation can act through many different ways to regulate transcription. And for this amount, for this percentage of the genes requires DNA methylation. Of course, the last experiment It was a validation of what we found with the RNA sequencing. We pick one of these genes that were downregulated by monocular deprivation and then upregulated by RG108, and one of these is NR4A1, which is also called NGFIB, which is known to regulate, again, spine maturation. And here you see that it's downregulated by monocular deprivation, upregulated by the NMT inhibition, And this is the bisulfite sequencing analysis of the upstream sequencing showing the enhancement of methylation induced by monocular deprivation. This, the black symbols are for the deprived cortex, and here you have methylation in the non-deprived cortex. So this was the last experiment of the project to see whether the functional relevance in terms of ocular dominance plasticity in physiological terms, and basically we recorded from the deprived animals treated with RG108 or control, and the result is either recording units or VEP recordings. The result is that in the animals that were infused with RG108 in the visual cortex, we had a block of plasticity. So this block of this part of the transcriptional program activated by MD was necessary to have the plasticity program. So, of course, if this DNA methylation is important during development, and also during this final part of development where the correct pattern of connections is probably set down, if these processes go wrong, there could be bad consequences on circuit formation. And one example of this is exactly the Rett syndrome. Why? Because in most of the cases, you have mutations of this MECP2 protein, which is actually ME, stands for methylated cytosine binding protein. So it's one of these proteins that should bind to the methylated DNA and then mediate the action of DNA methylation. And indeed, they have this part of the protein where it is the methylated DNA binding domain where that can interact with DNA. And also its localization in the cell, this MECP2, is really in the nucleus and actually in these hotspots of heterochromatin where you have high level of DNA methylation. Probably here, Rett syndrome very well. This is Andreas Rett, by the way, and this is the natural history of the disease, and you see that it's characterized by different type of symptoms, and there is, in particular, interesting is that you have this rapid regression after the acquisition of some skills, where you also have some autistic features. But it's important also to underscore that mutation on MECP2 are also found in non-Rett syndrome patients, are also found in autistic patients. And in some cases, these are mutations that only change the amount of MECP2, or for instance, by changes the epigenetic state of the promoter of MECP2. So there are cases where you find changes in methylation and you have a reduction of MECP2 expression. These have been found in non-Rett syndrome patients. What are the consequences of this mutation? In most of the case, neither in humans or in mouse, you never find neurodegeneration. Many people think that the problem is at the level of connection. So this is actually an old slide. Many people have searched for changes at synaptic level. And actually, the scenario is a little bit complex because, for instance, people have found that in the cortex, most of them agree that there is a reduced excitation, for instance. But if you go into subcortical structures, like in this part that is very important for breathing, and breathing defects are very important in Rett syndrome, in this case you have actually reduced inhibition, and so it could be that some regions are more excitable and some are less excited. But what is interesting in searching the synaptic phenotype is that you can focus your research on factors that are related to synaptic maturation. So, for instance, we analyze this pathway, the AKT-mTOR pathway, that is important, for instance, for controlling local protein synthesis, that is well known to be crucial for synaptic plasticity. And the circle that the factors that you find here in the red circle were all factors that were that we found were reduced in the rat mice in terms of phosphorylation of activation, not in terms of the level of expression of the non-phosphorylated protein. And again, these impairments were kind of specific for different regions because it were particularly pronounced concerning this pathway in the cortex and also in the cerebellum, but for instance in the hippocampus they were much less pronounced. Another thing that one can do if you know that you're tackling with synaptic defects, I go a little bit fast on these slides because this is published stuff, is try to counteract synaptic deficits by providing environmental stimulation, kind of rehabilitation, let's say. So we did this by performing this early environmental enrichment of these rat mice. The fact that it's early is quite important because with late environmental enrichment, we and also other group couldn't find much of an effect. But if you really put these animals in a rich environment from birth, we could see some amelioration in some behavioral tasks. For instance, one that was really improved was the rotor, the motor coordination. The motor tasks were really responsive to this environmental enrichment. Other aspects were not so improved. For instance, survival improved only in the male knockout that normally lives around 50, 60 days. We could see a prolongation of life of only 10 days on average. But what is interesting is that also some synaptic effects were responsive to environmental enrichment. So together with Maurizio Giustetto, a collaborator of mine in Torino, he went to the electron microscope so to be really sure that he was counting excitatory inhibitory synapses. And what you get normally in a enriched mouse is that you have, in a wild type, I mean, you have an increase in the number of excitatory synapses and a decrease in the number of inhibitory synapses. So here in the cartoon, you see the response to enrichment in a normal animal. What happened in a knockout? We could observe the increase in the excitatory synapses, but the inhibitory synapses did not respond to the environmental stimulation. So this led us to think that maybe this inhibitory neurons and the inhibitory inputs maybe are particularly suffering from the loss of MECP2. Another thing that we wanted to do was to go a little bit deeper in analyzing these synaptic deficits, and in particular the dendritic spine deficits present in this model. So together with Jim Miratto at the Scuola Normale in Pisa, we performed some two-photon microscopy of these apical tuft of these layer 5 pyramidal cells, and the idea was to try to see whether we could see a change not only in a static way, just counting spines or synapses, but in a more dynamic way, so being able to monitor the turnover of the spines, so the new spines coming, the spines that were removed. Unfortunately for the MECP2 model, since this animal is very sick, we were not able to do repeated day-by-day imaging. So what we did was basically to do a time-lapse of a few hours and then analyze, in this case, what is called the motility, so the dynamics of dendritic spines, but not the long-term turnover. First of all, we measured dendritic spine density to be sure that what we were observing with in vivo imaging was the same that you get in fixed tissue, and actually we could observe the reduction in spine density also with both techniques. And then this is a movie where you see the dynamics of the spines in a wild type, and this is a MECP2 knockout, P25. you see that while here, you see things going on, so some filopodia coming out or some movement. Here, there are less spines and they are kind of frozen, suggesting that there is no for much of a dynamic going on. And so many labs, in particular Mirganka, suggested that this motility of the spine is one of the first events leading to plasticity. It could be related to the loss of plasticity that is present also in these mice. These are just the quantification where you see that this is, for instance, the spine length of the head volume. Normally, if you take all the time series, you have this kind of variability, that's meaning that is dynamic. This measure changes spine by spine. While in the Rett model, it's more stable, so it's not changing. So we decided to see whether we could use this phenotype to assess the effects of a treatment. And again, following Mirganka work, we picked this IGF-1. So we perform the IGF-1 treatment, and then we image the dendrite of the treated animals. And you can see that here there is a little bit more dynamic than in the untreated rat mouse. And this is again the quantification. This is just a single injection 24 hours before the imaging. And you can see an improvement. These are the green line. It's not total. There's still something missing here, but it certainly improved. But as I said, this is the farthest we could go with this model because of the problems. I mean, it was really hard to get enough data from this model. So we decided also to have an idea whether this is a general issue or of Rett syndrome to analyze another mouse model of a variant of Rett syndrome, which is called the Hanefel variant. This is not caused by MECP2 mutations, but it's caused by mutation of this gene here, CDKL5. The difference with Rett syndrome is basically that there is no regression because the symptoms are present, they come out in the very first month of life. It's also characterized by seizure, by very, very, very important seizures. And then other symptoms are, you know, similar to the MECP2 version of Rett syndrome. Until 1 year ago, actually, you know, maybe something more, until the end of 2013, there was no model available for the disease. And actually, Cornelius Gross at the EMBL in Italy decided to make the model. Actually, this was done in parallel with the group of Zoo here in the States. And so we and them, we come out with a model more or less the same time. But there are slight differences in the way the model was done. We basically knocked out this exon 4, and this gives an unstable protein. And so basically CDKL5 completely disappeared. This is mRNA, and the protein. We immediately test, actually this was done in Cornelius' lab, not in our lab, but he immediately tested the presence of spontaneous epilepsy, because this is a kind of a hallmark in the patients. But unfortunately, this was not present in the mouse model, and the same result was observed in the model developed by the Zoo lab. So we think that the epileptic phenotype is not so pronounced, and this is in this mouse. Nonetheless, there are differences in the way that induced epileptic discharge are present, and in particular they are at low frequency, but they are longer in duration. So you know, there is a phenotype in this epileptic discharge that could be used to study also epilepsy in the CDKL5 knockout. There are behavioral impairments there is this typical hind limb clasping that is also present in the MECP2 mice. There is hyperlocomotion in the home cage. And also there is an impairment in the head tracking, and this is to a visual stimulus. This is also present in humans with this disease. And we observe a reduction in the visual evoked potentials, so cortical activity seems to be lower. And the similar results was obtained with auditory evoked potentials in the other model by the zoo group. We also had the possibility to cross the conditional model with mice expressing the expressing cretocombinase inhibitory neurons, or expressing the cretocombinase in cortical glutamatergic neurons, in order to see which of the symptoms were originated by defects in different populations. And for instance, the hind limb clasping was present in the mice with deletional CDKL5 in excitatory cortical neurons, but not when the CDKL5 was deleted in the inhibitory neurons. Whereas the hyperlocomotion was depending on CDKL5 in inhibitory neurons. So it's probably an action that is not limited to one population, but to more than one population, both excitatory and inhibitor. We checked some usual suspects. For instance, we checked whether the MECP2 expression was affected in this model, but it was not. So if you knock out CDK5, you don't change MECP2. In this model, we couldn't see any change in BDNF, and this is something that is different from what happens in the MECP2, where many groups have found that in the mouse model with MECP2 deletion, you have reduced levels of BDNF. But we could observe a reduction in this pathway, in the activation of this pathway, the AKT and S6 pathway, also in this model. So this pathway seems to be regulated in common between the CDKL5 model and the MECP2 model. We decided to go, considering the function, the cellular function of CDKL5, we decided to go a little bit deeper in the synaptic phenotype, doing again this two-photon imaging of dendritic spines. In this case, the rationale is even more direct than for the MECP2 mouse, because what do we know about CDKL5 function? Actually, we don't know much, but we know that it can be localized, can have nuclear action. It can localize to the so-called nuclear speckles for processing of RNA, but there is certainly synaptic localization, and there are two papers three papers, they actually found an interaction of CDKL5 with PSD95, so the organizer of the excitatory synapses. In this paper, basically, CDKL5 was necessary for the interaction of PSD95 with this cell adhesion molecule, which could contribute to the stability of the postsynaptic density. Actually, these other papers found that the interaction between PSD95 and CDKL5 could be actually regulated by activity. So when you have activation of the cell, entrance of calcium, the calcium calmodulin could display CDKL5 by binding PSD95. So there is really a rationale for analyzing the role of CDKL5, at least in excitatory synapses. But so our question was, what happens to dendritic spines in vivo? So first experiment was to implant a cranial window, a P30, in the knockout. These are X-linked disease, so basically we took males, which are full knockout. So we implant the cranial window, and then we do imaging at different ages. You see that basically for 1 month. And first thing we did was just computing spine density. And this is the spine density in the wild type. This is in the knockout. And you see that there is a big reduction in spine density, but also you can appreciate that there are small but significant divergence in this curve, meaning that the density is closer here than here, and this is significant. This suggests that there is some loss of spine during this period. We also analyze in functional terms what happens to excitatory input on these pyramidal cells that we do imaging on. So we recorded miniature excitatory postsynaptic currents, and we could observe a reduction in the frequency and also small reduction probably in the high amplitude miniature currents. LTP was, cortical LTP was extremely impaired in this model. But let's go to the dynamic view of the dendritic spines. So we first measure turnover in 4 days. This is a quite fast turnover in the adult. Basically, we counted spines that were present in the first day that are lost and those that are gained. And basically, we didn't see any difference. This is the gain, the black is the mutant, this is the loss, and there is no difference with this 4 days interval. So we decided to analyze the whole month of observation, and you see here in this graph, if you consider the number of spines that you had the first day of observation, how many of them you find during this period? So how many are left after 1 month? You see that there is this loss. And normally, you have this curve here that is for the wild type, while for the mutant, we could observe that the loss is more pronounced. And so basically, this shows that there is a less survival of the less long-term survival in the mutant with respect to the wild types. Other observations were consistent with the idea was the fact that the so-called new persistent spines, so the spines that you can see when they are the day when they are born, for instance, you could see, oh, here at P60 I can see this spine is new. Then I can classify as new persistent. This is where classification introduced by the Svoboda group. If I see this spine after at least 10 days, it means that it's persistent. And the percentage of new persistent spines is reduced in the knockout mice. Again, converging toward the idea that there is, let's say, long-term instability in the adult mouse. But what happens during development? Because, of course, the most intense period of synaptogenesis is during development. In particular, we analyze mice between P27 and P28. This time, we could do an imaging just one day after the other because we had a lot of dynamics. Because, during this period, you have a lot of spines that are added and a lot of them that are removed. So dendritic spines are already reduced at this age, so the big reduction that you see in adult is present even at P27, although it's smaller, probably, because the more that the time passed, the more that the animal lose spines. So the difference between the two animals becomes wider and wider and wider with age. You see that the reduction is mature spines and not for filopodia, suggesting that something that happens not at the level of spine formation, but at the level of spine stabilization. And I go straight to the quantification of the data. If you compare the data that the spines that are gained and lost in this 1 day period, you see that the gain is absolutely the same in the wild type and in the mutant. But what you have is a huge loss. So basically, the animals acquire a spine, but then some of them are lost within 1 day, are not stabilized. And this is not only present at the level of dendritic spine turnover, but also if one do this punctate staining for PSD95, which are clearly reducing the mutant, suggesting that it's not only a loss of spines, but also a loss of excitatory synapses. And this was true both with immunohistochemistry or doing Western blots on the synaptosomal fraction of the cortex. And again, can we use this phenotype to see the effect, to monitor the effect of a treatment? We treated the animals with IGF-1 because since the signaling defects was similar, probably maybe the same treatment could be effective on the same phenotype. So we did 3 days treatment before the imaging, and we could see that the spine density was increased during in this period. These are the mutants. These are treated with vehicle. These are the mutants treated with IGF-1, and also how was IGF-1 acting? Basically, was protecting the spines from the excessive loss that we've seen before. So there's an excessive pruning, basically, and the loss in the animals treated with IGF-1 was normalized. So this could be interesting to go on and see what happens on, you know, on behavioral aspects with IGF-1 in this animal. Okay, so I am finished. And these are the persons that are, of course, the key person for all this experiment. Paola Tognini was very, very important for the MIR-132 story and also to launch the epigenetic DNA methylation project. She is now in California, in Sassone Corsi lab, doing epigenetics. Elena Putignano, she did a lot of the imaging, and of course I cannot forget to thank her because she's actually my wife. So I would have problem at home if I forget to thank her. And Grazia della Sala, she's a postdoc that also did some imaging and some of the molecular biology. So thank you very much for your attention.
How long does it take for the deficit? So when you deprive the animal and you see these methylation changes, how long does it actually take for those changes to manifest in terms of both transcription, but as well as the levels of DNMTs?
We did only one time because it's also in correlation with the physiological data that we had before. So it was after 3 days of molecular deprivation. Concerning the histone post-translational modifications, in that case they were quite fast. I mean, with molecular deprivation we could observe them at 3 days after deprivation, but when we did this light-dark exposure, they were changing really in hours. So, yeah. But for the methylation we only did 3 days. Of course, one interesting question we would like to do is see where they persist, even if you reopen the eye, this so-called genomic memory, things like that.
So, do human beings with CDKL5 mutation have the same symptoms or the same phenotype as MECP2 mutations? And do they have smaller, you know, brain size, smaller neurons? You know, what is the
So yes and no. Depends on which symptoms. I'm going back to the list. Yeah. Stereotypies and I mean, this kind of symptoms are shared between the two diseases. Epilepsy. Okay. There are differences, a lot of difference between different patients. So there is also a paper saying that CDKL5 is a different disease. There is that actually designated this the CDKL5 disease. So probably there is an overlap with the differences, and also the early seizures that are present. is a characteristic of the CDKL5. So there is some overlap, but some difference too. And in terms of the brain size, no, in this case, with the CDKL5, it's not smaller.
The reason I ask is that, so I'm keen to know what Walter Kaufman think of this, because he actually runs the Rett, you know, clinic, at Rett program at Children's Hospital.
Okay, said it right.
The reason I ask is that in at least mice with MECP2 mutations, and even in human beings, there is less IGF-1 in the serum and even in the brain.
Yeah, we are measuring.
And so that is a, that is, and that then is consistent with the reduction in the IGF-1 receptor downstream signaling, which includes PI3K, AKT, mTOR, S6, and so forth. So you don't find a reduction in BDNF.
Not in
CDK. Have you measured IGF-1? But you do find a reduction in the signaling pathway downstream of the insulin or the insulin growth factor receptor. So it's a little bit puzzling.
Yeah, we are doing this experiment at the right now. I mean, we are measuring IGF-1 in the both in the adult, in the juvenile mouse, and we'll see what happens. Of course, it could still be that IGF-1 can, you know, stimulate something, but it's not per se reduced. I mean, and stimulate the pathway, and that's why it can help.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing
is that this is the pathway that feeds PSD95. So you have a reduction in PSD95, which is consistent with the MECP2 and also with Phelan-McDermid syndrome or SHANK3 mice.
Yeah.
And knockout mice, but there's a reduction of PSD95. And in all of these animal models, IGF-1 or BDNF for that matter would help, because it activates the signaling mechanism.
Exactly.
So I think that may emerge as an important theme in at least some subset of brain disorders that involve deficits in excitatory transmission.
Totally agree.
So that's an interesting. One thing that is remarkable about patients with CDK5 is that they have such a severe phenotype. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's really, you never see a milder phenotype like you see in MECP2 mutations.
So they're consistently very,
very affected. And the other thing, like, I have been thinking about this for a while, that they have seizures very early. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is what unified the group. We don't call them anymore Hannibal variant. Mm-hmm. We write in the record, but we call all of them CDK5 disorder, because only a small fraction of them have red-like features. And they have seizures that begin at age of about 5 months, even before that. And I suspect that that triggers a cascade of secondary events that lead to abnormal plasticity. And the other thing that is very remarkable, they are very hypotonic. Mm-hmm. And they have what seem to be cortical visual impairment.
Exactly.
Almost invalid.
Yeah.
And there is something, you know, very, very different from Rett syndrome, in which, you know, that maybe during the regression period they cannot have good eye contact, but they always have preserved overall visual function.
Yeah, you know, this part is recapitulated in the mouse model, the visual part reduced sensory evo potential, and also the fact that they do not follow the visual stimuli. For the epilepsy, I mean, both groups could not find this major phenotype. I mean, as I show, there are alterations, but it's not as big as one could imagine, because of the clinical phenotype that you are describing.
How many patients do you have who have CDK5 mutations?
When we began the project, we began to recruit quite a few. I have personally about 21.
I have a lot of patients in your clinic here,
in
the New England area.
In the U.S. Oh. There's another one at Children's Hospital in Denver. And one thing that is very interesting about the genetics of CDK5, and I have spoken with John Christodoulou about this, because I don't fully understand, because the phenotype is not very specific. In most patients, it's really severe developmental delay, these seizures, which are typical infantile spasm, myoclonic seizures, and sometimes other types, particularly the second half of the first year, is that some of them have what seem to be sequence variation in the regulatory regions, in the 5', And you never see that in with MECA2. It's all in exon 3 and 4 and a few in exon 1. And we all have been looking for the 5% or so that you pointed out, that why we have 5% of plastic patients that are MECA2 mutation negative, because we don't find anything in the regular region. We're always looking at exons. Mm-hmm. But that's not the case with sequence 5. You see a lot of sequence variation in the 5 prime region. And you start with the visual circle, and you say, well, the phenotype in general fits, therefore it's pathogenic, but the phenotype is so non-specific.
Yeah, it seems that, yeah, changes in the expression in for CDK5 is very, very important. That's the only thing I can comment on this. Yeah. Actually, I know, yeah, personally, one kid that, even a male that had this reduction in the expression of CDK5 and no mutation in the protein.
Good question. I don't know if I missed it. Have you measured many iPSCs in CDK5?
In the CDK5, yes. We measure from the pyramidal cells that were GFP positive. So basically, we targeted the same cells that we were doing imaging from.
Yeah.
So layer 5 pyramids. And there was a reduction. Where is it? It was a reduction in the frequency. And for the amplitude in the average is nothing, maybe.
No, but iPSCs? Oh. Inhibitory postsynaptic
cortex? Oh, inhibitory, sorry. No, we haven't done this. Of course, that would be...
Have you looked at the GEFRIN positive functor?
The GEFRIN, we haven't done anything on the inhibitory side. There is a... Maurizio Giustetto in Torino is doing this. We kind of, we collaborate, so we don't try... We work on the excitatory part.
All right, well, thank you very much.